going to be looking at today specifically. So there's going to be three PowerPoints on imperialism and three PowerPoints on World War One. And so specifically today, we're going to be focusing in on like the causes and the reasons behind imperialism. Tomorrow we'll talk about the Spanish-American War, and then on Wednesday we will talk about China and what's going on in Asia and kind of this competition for resources in China, and then that will take us to your quiz on Thursday. Okay? So we kind of talked about this a little bit at the beginning of the class, kind of the differences between colonialism and imperialism. Colonialism has the goal of going into an area that we would consider to be unsettled, that is kind of ripe to kind of move in and completely conquer, whereas imperialism is moving in, setting up a presence and some political economic control, but not necessarily like completely utterly like conquering those regions and wanting to make them a part of your country. We did not want to make the Philippines or Guam or Cuba necessarily a part of the United States. We just wanted to extract those resources and have those for our economy. Okay? So imperialism, the easiest way to say it, is stronger, more powerful countries taking over smaller, weaker countries. But the reason behind that is those smaller, weaker countries have stuff that we need, have resources or raw materials in their countries that we may not necessarily have the ability to produce. And the biggest thing is we need people to buy our stuff, okay, as John Green was saying, okay? So these are your four main causes of imperialism. You need to know these four, okay? These are your four main causes, and all of the things that contribute to imperialism can kind of go into and be classified by one of these four, okay? So number one is Anglo-Saxonism. Everybody say Anglo-Saxonism.
Anglo-Saxonism.
Okay. So Anglo-Saxonism is the belief that white Protestant culture and descendants of England are superior. Okay? How many of you are familiar with the Anglican Church? Okay? That's the Church of England. Okay? So Anglican, Anglo, that's where that word is derived from. Okay? So Anglo-Saxonism is the belief in the superiority of white, English-speaking, Christian people. Okay? And if we're talking specifically within religion, what type of religion specifically? Not just Christianity, but not Catholic, Protestant people. Okay? Because the Anglican Church, the Church of England, is the one that split off from the Roman Catholic Church because of the whole wives situation. So, Anglo-Saxonism, the belief that white, English-speaking, Christian, Protestant people are superior. And so that kind of base ideology is going to kind of set the precedent in the movement and the belief for social Darwinism. So take that belief of social Darwinism that we talked about with Herbert Spencer during the Gilded Age, and then take it on a global, on a macro level, and not just apply it to businesses and people within your own society, but apply it to world political and economic status. So the big countries, the fit countries, will dominate and rule and control over the smaller, weaker, unfit countries, because for some reason they are unfit for whatever reason. And because they are unfit, it's just inevitable that the larger, more powerful, more fit countries will just take them over. Okay? Does that make sense? So that, Anglo-Saxonism is going to kind of set the precedent from the belief for social Darwinism on taking over those smaller, weaker countries. So the fittest countries will survive and they will dominate on the world stage. A lot of what we're looking at during this imperialist time period is the United States fighting to get a slot in that top five. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to dominate and we're trying to prove ourselves on the world stage that we can compete with these dominant world powers. We can expand we can dominate, we can conquer, and we can compete on an economic level with these other larger countries. Okay? Military bases. And so not only just an economic presence, but we're going to start to see again this kind of notch up of militarism around the world. And we're also going to talk about a very specific book that really influenced our philosophy on expanding around the world. And if you look at all of these powerful countries in history, the common denominator there is all those countries have very powerful militaries, a military base. It's not just a powerful military, but a place to house them around the world, so you're not just expanding that political and economic influence, but also that military influence as well. And then the last one is overseas markets. These are in no particular order, but the fourth one, overseas markets. So in American history, for the last 50 to 60 years, the United States has been experiencing rapid what? Specifically, rapid what? Thank you. Industrialization. Immigration and urbanization, right? Now, and in this time period of manifest destiny, well, what's the problem with manifest destiny? What's the problem with industrialization and expanding? Eventually, what is going to happen? You're going to run out of places to go, people to sell to within your own country. So because of this rapid industrialization, we got to find people to buy our stuff. That's essentially what it boils down to. We've got to find more overseas trading partners so that our economy can continue to expand around the world. Okay? So this is just fleshing out the social Darwinism stuff a little bit more. John Fiske was just was an English philosopher at the time, just talking about how English-speaking people and Protestant people were superior, and so we should spread our beliefs and our ideas. This is also this time period where you're going to start to see, like especially last year, we talked about the social gospel, right? And this belief that the Christian church, the Protestant church, if society was going to get cleaned up, then the Christian church needed to also have a role in that. Well, you're going to start to see that expanding as well. As we expand around the world, then you're going to start to see the emergence of a lot of missionaries, and missionaries traveling around the world to plant Protestant churches where there typically wouldn't be, so in the Philippines and in Guam. Cuba and Puerto Rico were Spanish colonies, so they're already primarily what? Catholic, right? So Christianity is pretty much already there, but they're going to try to expand Christianity specifically into the Pacific, where that is not native to those people, okay? So you're going to start to see the emergence of missionaries and the church influence in the Pacific, in the Philippines, and in Guam, okay? So going back to this idea of a really strong military and overseas bases, this very important book is going to be published in 1890. You need to know this book. The book is called The Influence of Sea Power Upon History. Okay, you need to know that book. And it's pretty much self-explanatory. And so a man named Alfred Mahan writes and publishes this book, The Influence of Sea Power Upon History. And basically what he does is he examines world history and then examines, you know, what is the common denominator here of how these countries have always been so successful and so powerful and so influential. And the common denominator is a really strong military, especially a really strong navy. Because we're talking about expanding overseas, what you need to get there? Some boats, right? You need some boats to be able to get there. And so he talked about if the United States wanted to compete and wanted to be one of these world powers and wanted to compete on the world stage, then we were going to have to step up our naval game, essentially, okay? And so what he's proposing is that the United States send a ton of money and resources and spending into the naval budget. And so the United States does that and spends millions of dollars creating this the most technologically advanced navy in the world. Up until this point, it had really been England and Spain that had always had the most developed navies. And so the United States spends a lot of time and resources dedicated to that specifically to develop the most technologically advanced navy in the world. So we spend millions of dollars on all these brand new ships. All of these ships are steam powered. So what do you need to power a steam powered vessel? Coal. Okay? So that is how we are going to develop this, what is known as the Great White Fleet. Okay? Because the ships, compared to like the wooden ships, they look white. So, how do we make people trade with us? How do we make people trade with us, Kevin?
Go to war, buy them.
Buy them, okay.
Buy them out of debt.
Or, yeah, or force them to do so, right? So, how many of you have ever, like, studied Japanese culture at all? Or know anything about Japanese culture? So like, what do you, historically, and I'm talking like thousands of years, like, what is typically Japanese culture like and have been for thousands of years? If you look at Japan on the map, on the world map here, so Japan is a string of islands off the coast of Russia, China, and Korea, okay? And so Japan, because it is a string of islands, had the ability to really keep to themselves. And for thousands of years, Japan had done just that. It had really kept to themselves and had created a self-sustaining economy and a self-sustaining culture and society. And they didn't need outside trade, they didn't need outside influence, they were completely self-sustainable. Until the United States shows up in 1853, and so the Navy sends a guy named Commodore Matthew Perry to Tokyo with four huge black warships. And so they show up in Tokyo, and they're essentially like, hi, Japan, we're the United States. We're going to trade with you now. Does Japan have an option here? Not really, okay? They were so caught off guard by how developed and advanced, these ships were, and so they were like, they were really kind of coerced and forced to do so. Alright, so the Japanese, now let's think geographically. Why do we care about Japan? Right next to China. Also right next to where? Not yet. China and Russia. Okay? China, for hundreds of years, have been trading with Europe through the Silk Road, right? A little bit of review of world history. They have been trading with Europe for hundreds of years, but Japan, because they were an island, had the luxury and the ability to remain very isolated from outside influence, okay? And so, in 1853, the U.S. shows up with a bunch of warships and says, we're going to trade now. So the only reason that Japan became this, like, military power at the turn of the 20th century when they go off and invade Russia was because we had given them the military technology to do so. So we had kind of created this, like, animal that once we started, like, trading with them and giving them military power, and then they go off and invade Russia, we're like, oh, what have we done here? And so then we kind of had to backtrack a little bit and figure out how to work with them after they go off and invade Russia. So after we open up Japan to trade, what we cultivate and create is this relationship between the United States and Japan through the Treaty of Kanagawa. And you need to know these four components of this treaty, okay? You need to know the four components of this treaty, okay? This is very, very important. And so, they did not have an option. And so, the four parts of this treaty is that it gives the United States the ability to trade at two ports, okay? The United States could come to Japan and could do business in two port cities in Japan, okay? The second part would be, probably the most important part, is just peace between the two nations, that we have a diplomatic relationship with them, and that we are constantly working towards just maintaining a positive, peaceful relationship. The third part is, keep in mind, we're a long way from home, right? Like a real long way from home. And so there was a part of this treaty that said that if any of our ships were shipwrecked or were experiencing issues off the coast of Japan, the Japanese had to go assist those sailors and those ships, okay? And then the last part, and this is also very significant, because the Japanese could have stopped right there. And yes, we could have been allowed to trade with them. Yes, we could have had access to two ports. But not just we had access to two ports, the last component of this treaty says that the United States is allowed to disembark in those cities, and sailors are allowed to get off the ships and go into these cities to do business and eat at the restaurants and stay in the hotels and buy supplies and do all of that. That is very significant because the Japanese were very worried about outside influence, specifically about Western influence, because they were fearful that that would tarnish or taint their culture and the purity of their culture. So the fact that they're letting a bunch of, like, U.S. sailors who've been on a ship for, like, 3 months coming into their cities to do what U.S. sailors do, that was really, that was very significant for U.S.-Japanese relations, that they could have just let them show up in the port, unload, reload, and go the heck back home. The fact that these sailors were allowed to disembark and get into these cities was really significant, okay? 1854. Now, the problem with us doing business with Japan is, geographically speaking, that is a long way from home, right? And these ships are powered by what? Coal. We can only load up these ships with so much coal before you run out of room or you are too heavy. So what is conveniently halfway between California and Japan?
Hawaii.
Hawaii is. Okay. And so Hawaii had a very large native population and had forever. Had a very large native population. Hawaii, throughout its history, had been controlled by a monarchy. They also had a small parliament that also helped to make decisions, but it was primarily run by a monarchy. And so during the 1850s and 1860s, as the United States is starting to do more and more business with Japan, we realize that we need that fueling station on the way to Asia. And so slowly but surely, more and more Americans are starting to settle in Hawaii. Okay? Now, besides it being a fueling station, why is Hawaii also very appealing to the United States? Why do we care about Hawaii? What kind of food? Sugar. Tons of sugar in Hawaii. What else? Fruit. There's tons of produce, primarily pineapples. Tons of produce that grows in Hawaii that does not grow anywhere close to the United States. So those are resources that we would never have the ability to extract or have access to if we didn't do business with Hawaii. Okay? So what starts happening is a larger and larger white population starts moving to Hawaii. And they actually convince the parliament to change the Constitution of Hawaii to limit the voting rights of people who are not wealthy and who don't own like a specific amount of land. So literally these white people gained enough momentum and enough power and influence in Hawaii that they essentially stripped the poor people of Hawaii's and the native people of Hawaii's ability to vote. And so they completely changed the Constitution of Hawaii. That's what's known as the Bayonet Constitution, B-A-Y-O-N-E-T, the Bayonet Constitution, under the king. Okay? Then the king dies in like the 1880s, and the queen, a new queen, takes over. You may have heard her name, Liliuokalani. A lot, you might have heard that name before. She is the last monarch to be in power of Hawaii before we overthrew her. Okay? And so the queen comes to power, and she promises the Hawaiian people that they're going to get rid of all of this Western influence, all this American influence, and restore Hawaii to what it once was. And she actually traveled to D.C. with a bunch of, like, representatives from Hawaii to, like, lobby and ask the U.S. government to, like, freaking leave them alone, essentially, which was very unsuccessful. And then the United States annexed Hawaii in 1898. And so Hawaii in 1898 became a territory of the United States, okay? Hawaii does not become a state until 1959. So Hawaii and Alaska become the last two states of the Union in 1959. Alaska in like January, and then Hawaii is not later. It's later, it's like August, September. So Hawaii was the 50th state. Okay. So tonight you guys are gonna do some reading about what happened in Hawaii, but we essentially overthrew her. Okay. The last thing I want to talk about is this idea of Pan-Americanism, okay? And so, this idea of Pan-Americanism is really kind of cultivated because of the Spanish-American War. We have rid we have rid Cuba and Puerto Rico of Spanish control, and we want to go a step further and continue to completely rid the Western Hemisphere of European control. What does that sound like all over again? Bringing the Western Hemisphere of European influence. It's the Monroe Doctrine all over again. And so, essentially what happened is, you know, they start pushing this ideology of Pan-Americanism, and they start extending all these invitations to Central and South America to come to this conference. And so the United States tried to put on this, like, Pan-American conference in the late 1800s, early 1900s, to, like, host all these Central South American countries to, like, be all buddy-buddy with them. And, like, none of the Central South American countries show up. They're like, yeah, no, like, we're good. We're fine. And so then Teddy Roosevelt takes it a step further and offers to pay off Central South America's debt to Europe. So if he's like, you know what, I'll write a check to Spain, France, Portugal, Europe, you know, to Britain. I'm going to pay off your debt. So then, who are they in debt to? Us. So if we hold their debt, then we control them. Okay? So this idea of Pan-Americanism. But for the most part, Central and South America were like, we're good. Your money comes with strength. And we have a good working relationship with Europe. We're all right. Okay? Nothing of that.